So in this next talk, we will talk about ways of synthesizing DNA. And the first technique that we'll focus on is polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. So we noted in the last talk that one thing that all of the NGS or next generation sequencing techniques have in common is the use of PCR to generate the sequencing reads. So let's take a look then at polymerase chain reaction, or PCR, in a little bit more detail. PCR is one of the major ways that we have to synthesize DNA molecules, leading to more than a billion-fold amplification of specific gene sequences. The main components of a PCR reaction are the template, the primers, the nucleotide triphosphate building block, and the DNA polymerase enzyme, which isn't really shown on this slide. The DNA template contains the specific region or gene that you wish to amplify, such as the DNA extracted from a piece of hair, for example. Primers, or oligonucleotides, are short strands of single-stranded DNA that is complementary to the 3' end of each target region. Both a forward and a reverse primer are required, one for each of the different complementary strands of the DNA. DNA polymerase is the enzyme that carries out DNA replication. Thermostable analogs of DNA polymerase 1, such as TAC polymerase, which was originally found in a bacterium that grows in hot springs, is a common choice due to its resistance to the heating and cooling cycles necessary for PCR. This process involves cycling through 3 sequential rounds of temperature-dependent reactions. The first is DNA melting, or denaturation. The second is annealing. And the third is the elongation phase using the DNA polymerase. Denaturation begins by heating the reaction to about 95 degrees Celsius. This disrupts the hydrogen bonds of the double helical structure of the DNA and separates the strands into single-stranded DNA. Next, the reaction is reduced to about 50 to 60 degrees Celsius, depending on the physicochemical variables of the primers. This enables the annealing of the primers to their complementary base pairs on the template strands. Note that the primers are added to the mixture in excess so that they will preferentially bind to their complementary sequences versus the template DNA going back together. And lastly, the elongation phase begins by setting the reaction to the optimized temperature of the TAC polymerase, which is about 72 degrees Celsius. And typically, it takes about 1 minute for 1,000 bases to be added to the DNA strand. During the elongation phase, the DNA polymerase will introduce new nucleotides in the 5' to 3' direction, building on the 3' hydroxyl of each strand, so you can see they're built in opposite orientations for each of the template strands. These cycles are then repeated over and over again to generate more product. So you can see that with each round, you will get exponential increases in your gene of interest, and you will only amplify the region between the 2 primers over time. So this is an incredible technique for amplifying your DNA product. Since its advent, PCR technology has been creatively expanded upon, and reverse transcription PCR, or RT-PCR, is one of the most important advances. Real-time PCR is frequently confused with reverse transcription PCR, but they are separate techniques. In RT-PCR, the reverse transcription one, the DNA amplified is derived from messenger RNA. Using a reverse transcriptase enzyme, the cDNA can then be produced. This double-stranded product can then be used in PCR reactions to then amplify the product, producing an amplified version of the cDNA product. This is really useful if you want to express a protein of interest, because you avoid having any of the intron sequences present in your amplified product. Real-time PCR is also known as quantitative PCR, or qPCR, So don't get it confused with RT-PCR. RT, in this case, stands for reverse transcription, not real time. The Q is meant for real time. It monitors the amplification of the targeted DNA molecules in real time during the PCR reaction, not at the end, as in the conventional PCR reaction. Real-time PCR can then be used quantitatively to determine how much messenger RNA is present in a sample. This, in turn, is used to gauge how much gene transcription is going on within the system. This is great for comparing samples that have been treated differently, such as a control sample, and one that may have been exposed to something like UV light. So here are some PCR technique considerations. Sensitivity can be both a good thing and a bad thing in PCR. You can detect extremely small quantities of DNA that might be present, even down to femtomolar quantities. This is great if you're trying to catch a killer or identify a genetic disease, but great care has to be taken during this preparation, as contamination can be a real issue. PCR is also a technique that often has to be troubleshooted to get it to work well. If the template is not pure enough, it may contain inhibitors that block the reaction from happening. Furthermore, the template DNA may contain secondary structure that makes it difficult for the primer to bind well. Or if there's similar sequences within the genome, you might get a lot of background with unspecific sequences that are different from the one that you want. However, even with these challenges, PCR remains one of the most commonly used techniques in molecular biology and biochemistry labs, and has really revolutionized our ability to study different gene sequences and the proteins that they express. In addition to PCR, it is possible to synthesize genes artificially. This is sometimes known as DNA printing, and it doesn't require a template like our PCR-based method. Artificial gene synthesis is based on solid phase DNA synthesis, and it's possible to make a completely synthetic double-stranded DNA molecule, and it doesn't even have any apparent limits on the nucleotide sequence or the size that you can make. However, it's still kind of expensive, and so it's not typically used if you can use a PCR method to generate your product. Where this comes into play most commonly is in the production of small oligonucleotides that can be used as primers in the PCR reactions. These are usually single-stranded, short DNA molecules. So this solid phase synthesis is very similar to what we saw for the synthesis of proteins or peptides. So in the entry position of the cycle, a single base is going to be cross-linked to a bead support that will then be housed within a column so that you can trap your synthetic product. You'll notice that this is a nucleoside base. It doesn't have the phosphate group attached to it. And you can see that this alcohol position, the 5' alcohol, has a protective group on it so that it won't be reactive. That way, our first base is going to be attached at the 3' hydroxyl position to the bead. The protective group can then be removed once you've attached it to the bead. And you can add your first base for coupling to this bead matrix. So you'll notice that the DNA base that gets added is a little bit weird. It doesn't look like the nucleotide triphosphate that would normally be added in vivo for a normal sequencing reaction. Normally, the phosphate group would be at the 5' position. However, in the solid phase synthesis, the phosphate group is housed on the 3' position, and it gets added to the 5' hydroxyl position of the nucleoside that's attached to the bead. This is the exact opposite of what happens in normal in vivo replication of DNA, that's always moving from the 5' to the 3' direction, and you would be normally adding bases to that 3' hydroxyl. So this is kind of backward synthesis. You're adding bases on the 5' side of the molecule. However, this works really well, You can keep repeating this process by releasing the protective group and then adding the next base. At the end, you're going to cleave your product off of the bead matrix and then you'll remove it from your column. One interesting area that's coming online are DNA vaccines. These are able to avoid many issues that are associated with egg-based vaccine production by generating viral proteins within a host cell. To create a DNA vaccine, an antigen-encoding gene from the virus that's causing the disease state is cloned into a non-replicative plasmid, which is then delivered to the host through traditional vaccine routes, for example, needle injection intramuscularly. The host cells will then take up the plasmid and they will produce this protein or express the antigen. It will be presented on the surface of the cells where it will activate immune cells and cause the production of antigen-specific antibodies within the host. These can be safer than traditional vaccines that have live attenuated viruses and pose more of an infection risk. However, their efficacy may be less than traditional vaccines. In the next few sections, we will look first at bioinformatics and then at procedures that will allow the cloning and expression of specific genes.